मैम ज्योति मैम,
यस सर, यस सर, यस सर,
नागेश सर विथ योर परमिशन कैन वी स्टार्ट सर, एंड सुमोक सर विथ योर परमिशन,
यस थैंक यू, या प्लीज गो अहेड,
यस यस डॉक्टर रोहित,
अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल. इट्स विद ट्रेमेंडस प्लेजर I, Jyoti, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE-NCET, deem it a great honor and privilege to welcome you all to this webinar on a high-frequency application in communication system organized by Department of ECE-NCET. Small cheer and a great welcoming ambience makes everything merry. With this cheerful quote, on behalf of NCET management, first and foremost, I am gratified to welcome Dr. Somak Bhattacharya, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE, Indian Institute of Technology, BHU, Varanasi. We are extremely delighted and glad for your presence, sir, and very grateful for accepting this invitation. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Jitendranath Mungara, Principal, NCET, for always being the constant support. I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Mohan Kumar S., Professor and Dean QA, for his continuous support. I extend my warm welcome to Dr. Nagesh Kane, Professor and HOD Department of ECE-NCET, for inspiring us every day by quality of his action and integrity of his intent. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, madam.
I extend my warm welcome to Dr. Rohit S., Associate Professor, Department of ECE-NCET, as well as the convener of this webinar, for his untiring effort and guidance in organizing this webinar. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
I extend my warm welcome to Professor Ajay Kumar Dwivedi and Professor Srinivas TV, coordinator of this STTP, for the exceptional coordination in organizing this webinar. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Last but not the least, I offer my hearty welcome to all the organizing committee, faculties, Department of ECE, and also all the participants joined to this webinar. Moving towards the integral part of this webinar, now I would like to introduce today's guest speaker, Dr. Somak Bhattacharya. Dr. Somak Bhattacharya has obtained honors in physics from Scottish Church College, Kolkata in 2003 and received both Bachelor of Technology and Master of Technology from Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics in University of Calcutta in 2006 and 2008 respectively. He had carried out the M.Tech thesis in Giant Microwave Radio Telescope of Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. He is a recipient of University Gold Medal as he secured first position in M.Tech. He received his PhD degree in 2015 from IIT Kanpur, India. He had worked in Department of ECE at Indian Institute of Information Technology, Allahabad, for a year since December 2015. Since 2016 December, he has been working as an assistant professor in Department of Electronic Engineering at Indian Institute of Technology, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. He has received the prestigious Young Scientist Award from International Union of Radio Sciences three times, an Electromagnetic Theory Symposium 2013 in Hiroshima, Regional Radio Science Conference 2015 in New Delhi, and Asia-Pacific Radio Science Conference 2016 in Seoul. Owing to his contribution in the area of radio science, URSI has conferred him honorary lifetime membership. His current areas of interest lie in metamaterial, metasurface, periodic structures, optomicrowave devices, etc. With this short and span introduction, may I now hand over the session to the guest speaker, Dr. Somak Bhattacharya. Over to you, sir.
Okay, so thank you very much for your introduction. So can I share my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Please let me know. I am sharing my screen. Please let me know once you can see my slides.
Okay, sir.
Can you see it now?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
It is visible. Okay. And I am going for full screen. Can you see?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So should I start?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much to all of you, especially Dr. Dwivedi for inviting me over here, and especially the other fraternity group of the College of NCET. Okay, so I'm really thankful to all of you. So, yeah, so I am going to talk about the high frequency application in communication system. And good morning to all of you all. and going to bore you people, I believe, for the next 1 hour or so. So yes, so as already is, it has been introduced by Ms. Jyoti. So let me just tell you about that from where I am from. Yes, so I am from basically from Varanasi. Okay, and we are situated. Can you see my cursor over here? Can you see the cursor?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So yes, so we are located in the state of Uttar Pradesh. Okay, and situated on the bank of river Ganges, that you know that this city is very much famous and considered to be very old, and in fact it is somewhat a proverb is there, it is older than the history. Okay, and yes, so it is very much famous for the beautiful ghats along the river Ganges. Okay, so this is the one of, in fact, one of the snapshots. Okay, and it is also famous that one can, once you are visiting this particular place, you should not miss the famous Ganga Aarti, which happens during the evening time. Unfortunately, this time that now due to the COVID situation, all these activities has been stopped. But once the things will be normal, you are most welcome over here, and please visit this one. This will be a lifetime experience, I believe. And yes, so we as IIT BHU or Indian Institute of Technology BHU, we are basically co-located with the campus of the erstwhile Banaras Hindu University, which is considered to be the largest campus or largest residential campus of Asia. Okay, how large it is? Well, we are having a dedicated auto route, okay, within the campus itself, from the main gate to the another gate. Okay, so we are having that much bigger campus. Okay. And yes, so if you can, if you are able to read the Devanagari script, you can find that it is written over here, Kashi Hindu Vishwavidyalaya, Banaras Hindu University. This is the main gate. So as I have told you, so here the autos are plying between this one, this main gate, to other locations. And here you can take the auto and you are most welcome to move within the campus. Okay. And what you are doing, that once you are entering within this particular gate, you will find another one beautiful temple over here. Okay, this is not the famous Kashi Vishwanath temple, this is another Vishwanath temple, but this is also a tourist spot, and this is also very much neat and clean. So this is the basically the entry route from this around along this side. So while you are coming from the BHU campus, so you will first get this particular temple, and then the IIT BHU area starts. Okay, so we used to tell, yes, take blessings from Lord Vishwanath, okay, and then you are most welcome to enter into the IIT BHU campus. So welcome you all, and yes, so I am going to now, so all these stories are now over, means regarding this campus. Now I am going to talk about the some kind of, you know, that what are the technical things for which I have been invited today. So what do we mean by communication? So you know that since you are already in your BTech sec, I believe you people have studied analog communication already. Am I correct? Hello. I can't see something. If someone can unmute.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are able.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. So you know that what do we mean by communication? Communication is nothing but the exchange of information, right? So basically, from one, you need one source, you need one destination, right? So that the signal can go from the source to destination properly, right? So you can see, for example, you can see that, well, you are not telling anything, but with these ones, you are having different religious symbols, okay? So one can very easily, one can find out, or one can correlate that what is the message to be conveyed, okay? And you can see that old, that you can see the hieroglyphic script, or that some kind of that the old days cave painting, okay, or the, you know, that which has been written in the papyrus leaf, those kind of some kind of, you know, that you can see some of the images over here. Also you can see that the old Egyptian scripts and everything, okay. And this is the first telephone which was used for a long distance communication, and this which was basically discovered by Sir Alexander Graham Bell. So this telephone was meant by him, or this was discovered by him. Okay, and this is the first, very first one. Now, as the time progresses, what is happening, that these are the some kind of recent days of communications. Okay, for example, this is one of the FM radios. Okay, that where you can tune those ones. Okay, And this is the nowadays the you know that flat screen that light the flat screen televisions. Okay, and many of you are having nowadays the OLED or organic LED televisions, which have been already been launched in the market. This one is it is very popular. It was very popular in the last decade. In fact, all of us probably have that one in our pocket in the last decade, I believe, from 2006-07 onwards. That this is nothing but a digital camera, and perhaps many of you are using this one to listen to this particular webinar. And nowadays, every one of you are, I believe, are having at your home. This is nothing but a simple laptop. Now, all these things have been clumped together, and many of you are using this device also to listen to this particular webinar, which is nothing but a smartphone. Now, what is happening as the time progresses? So now you notice one thing, that you can do the work which you can carry out by laptop, or you can take some photographs or make some videos by using your smartphones, and you can listen to that, you know, that some FM channels or some any other videos you can see. Also, you can tune to a particular, you can subscribe and tune to a particular channel to view that one also. So this is the you know, that some kind of fundamental things related to the modern day communication. And here I want to tell you that most important part is you have to know about the electromagnetic spectrum. Since you people are from, basically you are doing the electronics engineering, so you should know about the electromagnetic spectrum. Means this is very much important. So what is happening, that you are having a complete range of the signals, okay? The spectrum means with respect to frequency, okay? So you can see that the lower frequencies, you can call them as radio waves. Then you can call it the microwaves, okay? Then you are having the infrared, okay? Then as you are going over here, visible UV, X-rays and gamma rays, once you are moving down in the frequency scale. And what you are moving up in frequency scale, and here what you can do the other way around, that here basically this is the having the smallest wavelength, and this is the down the wavelength, you can go over there increasing down, so you can have it over here. Okay, so wavelength is increasing in this direction while the frequency is going on in this direction. Let me do one thing. Just let me know if you can see my this one or not. So basically along this direction we are having the increase of frequency, and what we are having the other direction, we are having the increase of wavelength. Can you see my this particular the illustrations over the
yes sir.
Thank you. Yeah. So the different frequency bands, they are having certain applications or certain they are having different names. So the very first one that I'm going in the order of increase of frequency. So from few hertz to 10 kilohertz, this is the audio frequency or AF, which has been used for telephony application. The, you know, that for example, for the voice communication and so, okay. And then we are having the 10 to 30 kilohertz. This is known as very low frequency or VLF, very low frequency for the long distance communication. As you move up, then you are having the low frequency from 30 to 300 kilohertz for the navigational purpose, okay? Then you are having the medium frequency or MF for the radio broadcast. So 300 kilohertz to 3 megahertz, for example, if you consider the normal, so this is the radio, means I'm talking about mainly the AM radio, okay? And you know that the frequency of broadcast is basically 550 kilohertz to 1.65 megahertz. This is the conventional domain of the particular amplitude modulation radio, okay? Amplitude modulated one. So this is the standard one. So you have to make your channels over here, okay? Then you have to do for the high frequency applications for 3 megahertz to 30 megahertz. Let me tell you one thing, I forgotten to tell you. Till this frequency range, what is happening whenever the signal has been in fact generated from the source, basically what is happening, you are having the, you know that our atmosphere consists of different layers, and one layer is there as ionosphere, okay? So till this frequency, what will happen? That whatever you are basically launched, so they are getting reflected back and coming back to your Earth surface, okay? So this is still, in fact, you can say, this is still 3 megahertz. till 3 megahertz you can have this particular facility. Okay, after that what you are having, it will simply it will simply penetrate the layer and then it is going to the free space. Okay, then you are having the very high frequency or VHF used for the TV or the FM application. You know that, for example, if you consider your FM, you can consider the FM that lies between 88 megahertz to 108 megahertz. This is the standard frequency band of FM. For example, you can consider some channels like Radio Mirchi or Red FM, 98.3 or 92.5. So basically, they are nothing but the carrier frequencies. As you already studied the analog communication, I am not explaining the importance of carrier or the baseband one. So already I believe that you people know that. And this by TV, I am going with the original, this Doordarshan television. For example, if you consider the TV, you are having between 61 to 68 megahertz. This is one of the band. And here, the carrier, it was lying at 62.25 megahertz. Okay. And here, basically, in fact, already you know that here, basically, you go with VSV or vestigial sideband modulation. Already you know all those things you have studied, I believe, in your analog communication classes. I am not going to explain those one. Okay. If you go further in this range, then you are having the ultra high frequency between 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz, then followed it by the super high frequency by satellite, which has been used for the satellite communication, and then by the 30 to 300 gigahertz. This is for the extra high frequency for the defense radar application. Now, if you combine these three, the last three, if you just combine, you can consider this is nothing but your microwave frequency range. This is your microwave frequency band. And how you will define microwave? Well, you can have, if you just consider, for example, 300 megahertz, if you convert into the wavelength scale, you will get it 1 meter. And if you convert the other way around, that's 300 gigahertz to microwave, sorry, 300 gigahertz to the wavelength, you will get it 1 millimeter, okay? So this is the band of the microwave communications. Nowadays, what is happening? This band, if you just consider this particular one, EHF, so here it is between 1 millimeter in one extreme, another one is 1 centimeter, okay? Because if you see, this is nothing but a factor of 10, okay? Now, this one is nowadays known as millimeter wave band, okay? Nowadays that people thinking of millimeter wave band, or in fact, if you go further for the submillimeter wave band, so all of this, them are coming into the picture, okay? Now, after that, you are having the optical range. By the term of optical range, what I mean, this is basically you are having the infrared plus visible plus ultraviolet. So all of them are combined over here in the optical range. I will come to those ones. In fact, I will describe a bit. Okay, you will come to know about details. And here, so basically, what you can consider for a basic communication system, already you know you need a source from where the signal will have over here or will generate. Then you need a transmitter which will be used for modulation. Already you know you need a medium, transmission medium, to transmit the signal. You need a receiver where the signal will be received properly or demodulated. I'm just writing demod. Okay, so and then you are having the proper destination. Okay, so this is one of this is already you know the process of the communication. And also what you know that what are the basic figure of merits of the communication system, you need to first of all you need to know the signal to noise ratio, that is signal power with respect to the noise power. Okay, you need to know the noise figure, okay, that is input signal to noise ratio to output signal to noise ratio. These are some of the very important parameters in a communication system. And also the channel capacity. So basically what is happening, for example, if your carrier frequency increases, why we are going with the high frequencies, if your carrier frequency increases, then as per Carson's rule, what is happening, that is basically will tell you the bandwidth, okay, it is basically 10% of FC, 10% of your carrier frequency. So what will happen as FC or the carrier frequency increases, your bandwidth that will also shoot up, okay? And as your bandwidth will shoot up, so you know channel capacity C equal to bandwidth log to 1 plus SNR, okay? So this gives rise the channel capacity C that will in turn will shoot up. So basically what is happening, you can accommodate more number of channels over a single medium. So this is one of the advantage while going with the higher frequencies. That's why people are thinking for the higher frequencies. Okay. Now, with the high frequencies, as I have told you, the microwave and the optical one. So as if you can recall that, in fact, let me show you over here that it was ending it at 300 gigahertz while the next one is starting at 30 terahertz. So if you consider, so this one is between 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz, while this one, it is between 30 terahertz to some 3000 terahertz. Now in between, what is happening? If you see 300 gigahertz means 0.3 terahertz. So essentially here lies a gap, and this gap basically we'll call it as a terahertz domain or terahertz gap. It is also known as terahertz gap. I am just write like this way, terahertz gap, or in fact some of the literature it also call it terahertz window. I will come to this one in details. I will explain it. Okay. So this is the basic idea of the high frequency communications, and we will talk about only these three frequency domain applications in this particular talk. Okay. So in the wireless communication, basically, let me, in fact, all of you know about these three pioneers in this field. And luckily or fortunately, we are having one Indian over here that who had immense contribution, but what I personally believe he didn't get that much recognition when he was alive, that who had first demonstrated the wireless communication over us. In fact, you know that some kind of over a shorter space. Okay. So just let me tell you over here that Jagadish Chandra Bose, okay, while working in Kolkata, in Calcutta University, as well as in Presidency College, Kolkata. So he had made up a setup, okay. And I'm telling you, this setup was nowadays perfectly Make in India, that project. Means all the things have been done by himself, developed by himself, okay. Nothing was procured from outside. So what he has done, he has first made those one, and once this was successful, there was a big auditorium in Kolkata, which is known as Town Hall. So he demonstrated that experiment in Town Hall, and it was really, really applauded. And just to imagine during those time, 1890s, that India was not independent. We are under British Raj, okay? But still he was invited to Royal Institution London to showcase his research. So this is one of the photographs which is widely available in internet, that he is basically, in fact, you know, that he is showcasing his research in London, okay? On the other hand, Marconi, you can see that he had demonstrated this wireless communication over a larger distance, okay? So for the transatlantic communication between England and Newfoundland, he had made it. And these were the towers which has been used by Marconi, okay? Now, let me just show you one thing. In 1897, he had demonstrated this research. Just 100 years later, in 1997, okay, you can see that over here, this is this particular conference. This is basically a conference which is held in every year in US or in Canada. It is very, very famous conference, okay, and very prestigious conference. Just you notice that the title of the presentation is The Work of Jagadish Chandra Bose and 100 Years of Millimeter Wave Research. You just read the abstract, you can you can easily understand. Just 100 years ago, J.C. Bose described to the Royal Institution in London his research carried out in Calcutta at millimeter wavelengths. He used waveguides, horn antennas, dielectric lenses, various polarizers, and even semiconductors at frequencies as high as 60 gigahertz. Some concepts from his original 1897 papers have been incorporated into a new 1.3 millimeter multi-beam receiver now in use on the NRAO 12 meter telescope. Okay. So this is just you think of that, how advanced he was in his time, okay? And later he got some kind of, you know, that some kind of recognition. For example, this is one of the paper cutting from 2012 that here you can see that US agency is nothing but IEEE. All of you, I believe, have heard about IEEE. So that honors the works of J.C. Bose and C.V. Raman, okay? And you can see over here the plaque which was handed over here. So you can see that it was written over here, the first millimeter wave communication experiment by Jesse Bose between 1894 to 96. Sir Jagadish Chandra Bose in 1895 had demonstrated at Presidency College, Calcutta, India, the transmission and reception of electromagnetic waves at 60 gigahertz over a distance of 23 meters through two intervening walls by remotely ringing a bell and detecting gunpowder. For his communication system, Bose developed entire millimeter wave components such as a spark transmitter, coherent dielectric lens, polarizer, horn antennas, and cylindrical diffraction grating. And it was handed over in September 2012 to the modern day, there is a Bose Institute in Calcutta. So Bose Institute authorities, it was handed over from IEEE. Okay. And in wireless, this particular research continued in India after Jagadish Chandra Bose, the very next person who had really, you know, that prospered in this area was Professor Shishir Kumar Mitra. He was one of the professors in Calcutta University, and he introduced a course in the master's level of physics department. In the course was on wireless communication, and he was he had done a thorough study, okay, on the wave propagation in the ionosphere level. And there was a book which is very famous, that the upper atmosphere, published by S.K. Mitra or Shishir Kumar Mitra. And later he was the person that who is responsible to establish the very first electronics department in India for the having the undergraduate and postgraduate degree. That institute is nothing but Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics, University of Calcutta, which was established in 1949, okay, just 2 years after independence. Okay. And the advanced research also started in India at that time. One is the Siri Pilani in Rajasthan, and the person who was responsible, that he is nothing, he was no other than Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar, okay, then CSIR general, okay. And also the first institute which has come up for the advanced researches and teaching in India, that is IIT Kharagpur. So all those ones, if you see, they are more or less contemporary. Okay. So, and then gradually these things have come up, and people are doing some kind of extensive research in different areas of communication. Okay. Now, once you are coming to the satellite communication, one of the applications of the microwave communication. So what you are having? You are having a transmitter over here. You are having a receiver. So you can send signal from transmitter to a satellite, and this one, you know that it is known as uplink. I am just writing, okay. And here, this is the downlink, that when the signal has been received, it has been processed and sent back to the ground station. And one can write that F uplink, okay, that will always be greater than frequency of downlink. Why? Because you know that as the frequency increases, okay, the directivity, okay, that will also go up, right? And once you are sending the signal from ground station to the satellite, what you want, the directivity high means what? That it is basically you are going towards the pencil beam, right? So you should have as much more pencil beam as possible, okay? So that is the high directivity. And what is coming down, what you want? Well, the signal may be distributed over a larger area. So that is the reason that why the uplink frequency is higher compared to the downlink frequency. Also, you know that there are some kind of, yeah, there are other reasons also, that like you can have the, there should not be any interference and so. So I am not going to the those ones, but this is the main reason, okay? And from the Indian contribution, the satellite communication, that it was the first satellite made by India, that is known as Aryabhatta, and the person who is the pioneer of Indian space science, that is none other than Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, okay, the founder of ISRO, all of you know, okay. And also that another important aspect regarding this one is nothing but the radar, okay. So in radar, what is happening, that you are basically transmitting some signal which is going over here, it is propagating in the free space, and you are having some target, okay, and you are having the reflection from this target. So from this reflected pulse or from this reflected signal, you can analyze that what you are having over here, or what is the characteristics of this particular target. And this is known as radio detection and ranging, if you go with the acronym. Now, radar frequency band. So this one I'm telling you, you know that how this one was originated. During the World War II, okay, that first radar was used commercially. And during that time, whenever the people were, the soldiers were talking or the colonels were talking, what they had done, they had made some kind of, you know, that code language so that they means so that they can communicate with their, you know, that with their friend circle, so that the others, the enemy camp, cannot detect the one. So what they have done, they use some kind of code language, and this was made by those. So maybe AL is between 1 to 2 gigahertz, and then S from 2 to 4 gigahertz, then C, X, KU, KK lying between 4 to 8, 8 to 12, 12 to 18, 18 to 26.5, and 26.5 to 40 gigahertz respectively. Now this one was later adopted by IEEE, okay, and they have also made the same band, okay. Also, in fact, they have gone for the another modern day band like this way, but people hardly go with this particular nomenclature. Still, this one is more popular, and this one, in fact, people call it the microwave frequency band. So microwave frequency range, okay. So people also consider this particular one. This is basically the subdivision of the microwave range. And people consider between 1 to 40. If you consider this 40 gigahertz, you can consider that in the, if you, once you are moving towards Ka band, and after Ka band, you are having the millimeter wave. Okay, so you can just make a comparison like this way. Okay, and let me tell you that here is one of the antennas which basically used for the deep space network antenna, which was been used for basically it has been used for the higher frequencies in X band. Okay. And here, this one, you can have it. It was established in Indian Space Science Data Center, Bilalu. Okay, I believe you people know this place much better than me. Okay, in 2008 under ISRO, and this was the one when it was under construction. And here, the two persons who were the forefronts of this one. So, he's Professor Adant Krishnan. He was the He's Professor Adant Krishnan. He was the previous director of the GMRT facility. Okay, and you can have over here Mr. Thepane, that one of the mechanical engineers, the chief architect, that who had made this kind of facilities in India. So now I am coming to one of the very interesting applications of the high frequency, which is known as the radio astronomy. Well, what is this? If you consider the electromagnetic spectrum, I told you, if you are going with the one for the, if you, for example, if you consider the wavelength scale, okay. So for example, 1 meter means, so here, this is basically your 300 megahertz, right? And this is your 3 megahertz, okay. So here, so if you consider this one is 30 megahertz. Right, this is in the wavelengths, in the frequency scale. So I told you before 30, the atmosphere, the ionosphere is opaque in nature, so no signal can transmit. Okay, so this is that here the ionosphere is opaque. If you go to the very high frequency, what you are having, our atmosphere is opaque. Okay, and in the IR domain, you can see that the windows are very small in width. You are having certain width in our optical domain. Optical means by this particular optical, whatever it has been written over here, you can consider that is nothing but visible. Okay, so this is the visible. So what you can have now, if you now come to the radio window, so radio window, basically you can see this lies in the microwave domain, because this is between 300 megahertz, and once you are going it over here, this is very much active till, you know, that that till 3 gigahertz or till 10 gigahertz. Okay, for example, if you consider it over here, that this is something around 10 gigahertz, this particular one. In this domain, you are having the radio window opacity. Okay, so basically you can have the radio window over here, and what you can do, you can make a better observation over a larger scale. Okay, now if you consider this one, so basically what you can do, you can study the universe at the radio wavelengths or at the microwave wavelengths. So this is the basic idea of the radio astronomy, and it was first started in 1930s as an offshoot of the developments in the radio communications technology. I will come to that story very soon. So here I am telling you something, that astron means star and nomos means law. So basically the laws of stars and that ESO, the astrophysics has developed, that which is basically nothing but you are having that from this astronomy, the study of the celestial objects. Okay. Now, if you move forward, so this astronomy, it has been done in different scales or different regions like infrared, gamma ray, X-ray, optical domain, or ultraviolet domain. Okay. So there are different kind of scales. Now, I'm coming to this one. So why it is important to have in different ones? So for example, our universe, the different objects, if you are making the imaging, okay. So basically this is the nothing, the one that what you can see. Okay. For example, in every one of our eye, we are having a visible filter. We can detect any object which is between 400 to 700 nanometer. Okay. We can see that one. And beyond this limit, we can't see anything. Okay. So we are having a kind of bandpass filter in our everyone's eye. Okay. So what we are doing, for example, I am seeing something. So what does it mean that object is making some kind of image within my eye, and that's why I can see it by my eye, okay, through my eye. Okay. So for example, this is the optical domain, one horse head nebula was imaged. Okay. One Cassiopeia, one of the distant object, it was imaged. And one galaxy is there, you can see the optical and the IR domain, and this is the UV domain representation of another galaxy. Now this is the story which I wanted to tell you, the radio astronomy, that how it was started. So Karl Jansky, he was an engineer in Bell Lab, and he went to the field to do some kind of measurements. Now what he was doing, that while he was taking the measurements, by the way, can you see me? By the way, can you see me? Hello?
Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, yeah. So what you are having, if you are having a distant object, for example, that object is rotating, and what you are doing, suppose this is the tip and here it is emitting some radiation. And what is doing, it is also moving around its axis, and whenever it is pointing like this way towards the Earth, it is emitting the radiation. So if you can observe it, he was getting some kind of signal which is periodic in nature, okay? And he was getting some peaks. And that time he was not aware that why this one is coming, because, and this is somewhat, that's strange. And later it was found that this is nothing but an emission from a rotating neutron star or rotating object. Okay. So this radio astronomy one, this was also this kind of research started in India. And the person who led this research, he is no more with us. So he's Professor Mrinal Kanti Dasgupta, okay, from University of Calcutta Department of Radio Physics and Electronics. Okay. So with this, you can see an antenna over here in Manchester. From there, he had gathered the data, and he had made some kind of imaging. And later, when the imaging system was improved, that this was the same object which has been imaged. So you can see that he was means very much accurate during those days. Okay, this story also, I mean, is this means how this image was made, I will also tell you within few minutes. Okay. Now these are some kind of telescopes for other frequencies, like in UVs. This one is the Subaru telescope in Hawaii. This is the Hubble Space Telescope for the infrared domain, okay, which has been basically already there in space, because infrared is not that much. I already have shown you the window is very much limited, okay. And what is there in the radio telescope? Well, I am telling you in a very, very easier way. A radio telescope is nothing but a simplified, modified version of a simple super heterodyne receiver, okay. All of you know in a super heterodyne receiver, which has been used for the AM demodulation, right? What you are doing, some signal has been received, and you are having some kind of local oscillator where you are mixing the signals and down convert it. And what you are doing successively, you are separating out the IF frequency and process it, okay? Same thing, okay? So basically the signal has been received and then successively processed. So this is one of the single dish radio telescope. Okay, you can see the largest one probably that which was existing. Why I have used was, just I will tell you within few seconds. It was there in Arecibo in Puerto Rico, okay, 305 meter in diameter, okay. Unfortunately, last year what happened, that some cables have been broken, okay, and some other things have come up. So you can see this is the one of the paper cutting that in you can see over here in the 22nd November 2020. So this was no longer in use. Okay, so this is one of the you can say that yes, after giving a service for a very long days, now it is of no use. Okay, and in India also that single dish radio telescope had come up in a 530 meter long and 30 meter wide. It is located in Ooty, okay, in Ooty Radio Telescope or ORT, okay. So in which it was operating in 326.5 megahertz, okay. And now I am coming to one of the important aspect that with a single dish, what is happening? You know that the main thing is the resolution. So basically, if you consider about the resolution, you know, resolution you can consider it is lambda by d, where lambda is the operating wavelength and d is nothing but the dimension of the antenna. Okay, now dimension of the antenna, if I ask you to make a very very huge antenna of maybe some kind of 500 meter or 1 kilometer, it is impossible to make from mechanical point of view or civil point of view. If I ask you for 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers, it is not possible. But to get a better resolution, okay, because as this resolution limit goes down, you are having the more resolution, right? So basically what you can do, that basically and what do we mean by resolution, that is you can separate out two closely spaced objects in space. Okay, so what is the way out? One of the way out is you go with lambda as less as possible, and another way out is you increase d as much as possible. Okay, so basically how you can do that, you have to use an array, okay, an antenna array. So one thing is, well, you are making an antenna array, so d has been increased and your resolution power goes up. Okay, so with this antenna array, now here another one, suppose you are making it like this, and this is your source from where you are seeing it. Now earth is rotating, this is an antenna array you are keeping. Now this is the kind of dimension which basically it has been projected. Now earth is rotating, suppose it is coming like this way, so dimension is changing. Here is another way, again the dimension is changing. So what will happen, this dimension is becoming a function of time. So at different time you are getting a different kind of resolving power or resolution, but that is not expected. So what is the way out? You make it in a shape of Y. A simple example is, for example, if you consider your ceiling fan, it consists of three blades. Why? If I go with two blades or if I go with one blade, what could have been the problem? The problem is you cannot have the proper coverage or uniform coverage and as well as optimized one, right? So with three blades of fan, you can have the optimized coverage of the, you know, that the air circulation. Similarly, whenever you are considering this particular one, okay, that this particular Y shape, so what you can do, that you can have it like this way, that so that it were having the uniform coverage. Okay, now these are some of the array radio telescopes, okay, that all over the world, like in eMerlin, Atacama, Astron, VLA or LOFAR. Now regarding this VLA, the very large array, let me tell you this, the image which was basically, yes, which Professor Dasgupta had done. So this was later improved by having the measurements from VLA, a very large array. You can see some of the minor things have been pointed out, or because by using, because you are having a better resolution. Okay. Yeah. So in India also, the Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope had come into the picture. Okay, and it was established from, means if the work has started from 1980s. And later in the late 1990s, it was sanctioned from the government so that people can come and do the measurements. Okay, so these are some of the panoramic views. And GMRT is basically located 90 kilometers away from Pune. Okay, if you go towards the Nasik, okay, you will get this particular structure. Okay, it's a beautiful one. Once you get the opportunity and things will be normal, I request you to visit this particular facility. You really love it. And these are the some of the receivers of GMRT. In fact, I am just showing some images. And just this is also another thing, another important one that I want to tell you. In the last year, GMRT accorded, in fact, it is also the IEEE milestone status. This is the very, in fact, you know, the very fascinating news. And you can see that this is the third countryless facility to bag IEEE milestone. I already told you the other two. The first one was Jesse Bose, the work of Jesse Bose and C.V. Raman together. These are the first two milestones, and this is the third one. Okay, and you can see the plate over here that GMRT consisting of 30 antennas of 45 meter diameter each, spanning 25 kilometer near Pune, India, is one of the largest and most sensitive low frequency radio telescopes in the world. It pioneered new techniques in antenna design, receiver systems, and signal transport over optical fiber. GMRT has produced important discoveries in domains such as pulsar, supernova, galaxies, quasars, and cosmology, greatly enhancing our understanding of the universe. Let me tell you another thing, that here also the complete GMRT facility, when it was made, it was also made in India project. Okay, so this was means all those things have been done over here and assembled over here and made in India. It was nothing was have been procured from outside. And the person, the mastermind over here, that his photograph I am showing over here, unfortunately, we lost him last year. His name is Professor Govind Swarup, okay, who is known as the father of radio astronomy in India. Okay, and I let me tell you one thing, that if you can, I'm just showing you some screenshots. So this one I will tell you, especially the students, that during your spare time, please read about his biography. So you will really love it. So if, for example, this particular manuscript is an open access one, you can easily download from your home also. So you can see the abstract. In this paper, we pay a tribute to father of Indian radio astronomy, Professor Govind Swarup, BSc, MSc, PhD, FRS, by celebrating his 90th birthday and recounting his remarkable scientific achievements in three different regions of the globe, Indian subcontinent, Australia, and the United States of America. Let me tell you, he was pursuing his postdoctoral studies in Stanford University, from where he had already got the offer for the faculty. But at that time, he was invited to India to work over here. And you know who invited him? He was the then principal scientific advisory of Prime Minister of India, Dr. Homi Jahangir Bhabha. Okay, he himself had written a letter to Professor Swarup to come and join over here to work in India. Okay, so just think of his legacy during at this small age. Okay, and I got a chance to meet him. Okay, during while he was alive, and yeah, he visited IIT Kanpur when I was a student, and many times I visited Pune. Okay, when I got an interaction with him, this is within the NCRA campus itself, this particular drawing, the visitors lobby. And this is in Pune, in his home. Okay, and let me tell you, the selfie was clicked by Professor Swarup himself. Okay, and this was just a couple of years earlier in Asia Pacific Radio Science Conference in New Delhi, in India. Okay, this was my last meeting with him, and during that time he was near to 90. And let me tell you, he had given a speech, and while giving the speech, he was standing tall in the podium and giving the speech. That it is not the thing that like some is sitting in chair or taking someone's help. Just think of the scientific, you know, that I should say the scientific dedication for this kind of person. And yes, the GMRT was visited during the construction. It was visited by Ratan Tata. You can see him in the picture over here. Professor Swarup is sitting over here. And Professor Swarup, let me tell you that he was very much gentle in nature, and always he will talk with you with a gentle smile. Okay, and he was a very nice person. So this is the one that you can see, that Dr. Ratan Tata himself is investigating the site and seeing that what is going on. Okay, and by this one you can see that why it is important that you can make a imaging of the source. Okay, so once you are doing that at different wavelengths, like the same Crab Nebula, you are making it in X-ray, optical, infrared, or radio wavelengths. So at different wavelengths, you are having the different kind of imaging. So what is the meaning of this one? What is the inherent meaning? Inherent meaning is whatever you are seeing, that is not final. Okay, at the optical domain you may get something, at the microwave domain you will get something, at some other domain you will get something. So by imaging you can get some different informations of the single same source. Okay, so this is one of the very, very important aspect of any kind of this kind of scientific discovery. Okay, So I can show you the our own Milky Way. If you do the imaging, okay, you can see a different wavelengths you are having, the different kind of imaging, okay, and you can see that, well, there is no correlation at all at different wavelengths. So you can find out, well, that what are the basic constituents of the Milky Way. You can come out from the different ones, because suppose you think like this way, some of the elements, they are emitting at the microwave wavelengths, some of them are emitting at the IR wavelengths, some of them are emitting at the, you know, that in the X-ray region. So once you are getting all of those data, you can compile and say, well, this particular object is having that element A, compound B, element C, and so on. Okay, so those kind of things you can make from a particular imaging. Okay, so this is about the radio astronomical things that what I have discussed. I am now kindly quickly to the optical communication. In optical domain, what you have, you are having the same thing, but you need an optical transmitter, which is nothing but laser. You can also use light emitting diode, and then you are having some kind of within a fiber optic cable, the signal will propagate. Okay, and then you are having the optical repeaters. Okay, and then again it will be demodulated by using the photodetectors. Okay, so basically what this will do, this will convert the signal from the electrical to optical one, and photodetector will do the reverse one from optical to the electrical one. Okay, and I am telling you, in the optical fiber, once you will do this, so basically there are two wavelengths. One is 1.3 micron. Let me write it over here. In 1.3 micron micrometer, you are having zero dispersion. Okay, zero dispersion. Okay, another one is 1.55 micrometer, where you are having the minimum attenuation. Okay, what do we mean by dispersion? Already you have studied in your class 12 that when the white light was incident on the prism, it was basically means it was basically converting into seven different constituent or elemental colors. Okay, so essentially dispersion is nothing but you can consider the dissolution of the signal, okay, in the compound signal into this elemental one. Well, now what is important, why this has been one, because if you consider each and every color, they are having different frequencies or different wavelengths. So what they will give rise to, they will give rise in turn the different refractive indices. Okay, so this is one of the important aspect, so that you want to reduce it as much as possible. Okay, so what is happening? Well, whenever the signal will be there, that for example, if you consider the RF signal or the microwave signal, it is basically, if you consider it is moving in the free space, you are having some kind of loss, right? A huge loss. So basically the solution is RF over fiber. So what you are doing, your fiber is your medium, okay? And you are propagating, or you are allowing the RF signal to propagate through this one. So it has been used for some kind of broadband mobile communication, used for some kind of generation of millimeter wave signals, okay, and also used for some kind of satellite earth station remote antenna remote system. I am not going into much details over all these ones. I am showing you rather one of the examples. So I am telling you that what we are having, so in the optical communication system, here I am showing you a wavelength division multiplexing. Okay, so excuse me, can I take some 10 more minutes? May I ask the organizer?
Sure, sir.
So some 10 to 15 minutes I will take. Okay,
no problem, yeah. Sir, no problem, sir.
So what we are having suppose different lasers, they are emitting at different wavelengths. Okay, and you know that this is SLM, means with the single longitudinal mode, so it is not having multiple modes. And you know that like our multiplexing system, here also the signals are getting multiplexed, and we call it the MUX. And once it is basically propagating the other way around, you are having the demultiplexer, and it has been detected by different receivers. Now here with the same channel, you can see one of the interesting one. If lambda 1 is not equal to lambda 2, what you can do, you can see that lambda 1 is generating from this end, the transmitter of lambda 1, okay? It is going, and here you are having the channel, okay? It is going like this way, and here it has been received in this case, okay? It has been received over here. This is your lambda 1, okay? On the other way, let me go it with a square. here I am having lambda 2, it is coming over here on the other side, okay, and then it is propagating through the channel and received it in the other direction, okay. So what is the beauty over here? You can have it over the same channel. You are having lambda 1 is propagating from left to right, while on the other hand, lambda 2 is propagating from right to left, provided lambda 1 and lambda 2 are much separated, okay. So this is the, you know, that the even within the multiplexed channel, you can make this kind of bidirectional flow. So with this one, let me show you that one WDM system which was used in the GMRT. So basically, this is the transmitter. These are the laser. This is the laser source. Okay, and what you are having, this has been connected to the multiplexer over here. Okay, and here there are demultiplexers, and here is the receiver system. Okay, you can see all those ones in the same figure. Okay, so what it has been done? So this is the basically you can consider like this way that, well, this is the front-end system where the signal has been received with two orthogonal polarizations so that there is minimum overlap, okay? And then you are having some kind of LNA or local noise, low noise amplifier, so that your noise figure is very less, okay? And signal is properly amplified. And then it has been, in fact, you know that you are using some kind of splitter so that half of the signal is basically going to towards IF range for some kind of processing. Then you are having the amplifier over here, and then you are having two kinds of transmitter, okay, OTX1 and OTX2, okay, and they are operating at the two different wavelengths, okay, and here you are having the multiplexers. They have been multiplexed together, and then they are ever having the demultiplex, so that you are basically having this in the receiver received as ORX1 and ORX2, and through separate out LHCP and LHCP, okay, the two orthogonal polarizations, okay. Now what is happening? This is basically operating, this particular one, this is operating at 1.55 micron, okay. Now the other one, I am telling you that here you can see one of the interesting one, you can see this is the WDM coupler, you can see this is operating this portion at 1.55 micron. This is at 1.55 micron. While the other case, you can say that here it is operating in the 1.3 micron and here it has been received at 1.3 micron. So the same concept of, in fact, the concept which we have just mentioned a few slides earlier, okay, about the bidirectional flow, that can be satisfied by this particular system, okay? So this is one of the interesting applications over here. And in a particular link, whenever you are designing, okay, one of the interesting thing is, well, in every case we consider that, well, our link basically it is a linear system for our calculations and everything, but in practice, you know, it is highly nonlinear. And once you are going with nonlinear system, you will encounter number of frequencies, a number of harmonic, subharmonic, and other mixed frequencies. And if you are having two frequencies which are very close and propagating over a channel, okay, if the signals are F1 and F2, the significant third order interest frequencies are 2F1 minus F2 and 2F2 minus F1, okay. So the point where they are meeting, in fact, I am coming to over here. So what is happening? These two ones, okay, the F1 and F, these ones, basically they are, if you plot the output power with respect to input power, the fundamental frequencies, they follow this particular one, while the third order one, it will basically follow the 3:1 graph, okay, or 3:1 this particular slope. So what will happen? That this will go on increasing very high and suddenly they will meet. This is known as third order intercept point. And the thing is, you have to operate much below to this particular point. This is the this is the one you have to pick here, okay. Now once you are going with these ones about the third order in this particular one, how you can experimentally characterize it? Suppose you are having two signals, F1 as 500 megahertz, F2 is 501 megahertz, and 3 dB combiner means that both are having the equal amount of power, and then you are having an amplifier, okay. Now this is a DFB uncooled transmitter, means you can consider this is your OTX, okay, and this is your optical fiber. I can write it over here, fiber, and this is your ORX, so that you can have it. They separate out the signal and then you can see in a spectrum analyzer. So what you can do, well, 2F1 minus F2 will be 499 megahertz and 2F2 minus F1 will be 502 megahertz. Now you notice all these signals are extremely close with each other. What you can do, if you go on increasing the input power of both the signals, what you can see, these are the fundamental ones, M1 and M2, okay? And M3, M4 are the third order intercept points. You can see that they are also going out, okay? Now, you have to stop somewhere so that what you can do, that here is the one which you have done for the fundamental one. Here is the one, the variation you can see for the particular, you know, the third order intercept points. Now, once you are going on this one, if you're going on increasing this one, okay, and if you extrapolate these ones, at some point it will meet, and you will find that is something around 30 dBm, okay. The basic idea is you have to operate much below this particular one, okay. So this is one of the idea, okay, that what is the significance and how you have to take care of all these ones while doing the measurements, okay. And here I was, in fact, as Ms. Jyoti had mentioned in my while reading out my biography, I worked in GMRT during my master's days. So this is one of my photographs in 2008 when I was over there. Okay, so one of the antennas in W4, I was working over there. So you can see that with these optical links, I consider myself really lucky to get involved in that group and working over there. And let me tell you that some 500 megahertz signal was transmitted from the other end and it was going for the testing. So that this W4 antenna is something around 15 to 16 kilometer away from the main center. And you can see the peak was received again at 500 megahertz. So this is the beauty. So what you can see that this is the noise level and here is the signal level. So you are having, you know, that clear signal to noise signal can be really, it can be detectable from the noise level, okay. And so what I now, till now, whatever I have told about that is over the RF as well as the optical one, I have told you at the starting that I will talk about terahertz, okay, I will take a few minutes. So basically microwave or the electronic domain that is basically coming, and this is around 300 gigahertz already we have seen from the electromagnetic spectrum, while in the optical domain that starts from 30 terahertz. Now here in between, what is happening, this range, there's the terahertz gap or THZ, okay? So 0.30 to 30, okay? Now 1 terahertz, it basically, if you convert it into time period, so it will be 1 picosecond. And if you convert it into wavelength, okay, that is 300 micron, okay? And the 300 micron will consist of the energy of 4.1 milli electron volt, okay? You can make simply you can convert it equal to E equal to HC by lambda, okay? You can make it from there, okay? And what is the application? Well, the application is that I am telling you, this is much, you are, in fact, I will come to, I will come to the next slide. You will learn more that, but what is the thing? Well, if you go to the terahertz, you are having more bandwidth. There is no doubt. But problem is, since it is within the gap itself, so what you don't have any kind of ready-made instruments available. You have to properly customize. And once you are going for the customization, so what will happen? The price will go up tremendously. Okay, that is one of the problem of working in the, or that's one of the challenges to work in the terahertz zone. So I am showing you here what has been done, that for example, a GaN has been, in fact, it is kept within a particular gap which can be easily detected, or this person is carrying some weapon, okay, that beneath the newspaper, which is all easily detected. So what you can do, you can use it for the security purpose very well. Also what you can do, that nowadays for that that if you consider the, for example, from the from the imaging point of view, while you are doing the X-ray imaging, okay, from biological point of view, since the energy associated is much less, so what you will have, that you will have a much lesser biological effect, okay, or much lesser, you know, that any kind of other effects within your body, okay, that which is prone to X-rays. Now, if you are going to the other ones, so we do some kind of researches in high frequencies. For example, some antenna has been designed, okay, that, okay, so this is the work carried out by one of the summer interns worked with me, okay, and he has done a nice work to, in fact, with the, that with the, but from a simple MicroStrip antenna design, he had come up with a final design of a, you know, that multi-band terahertz antenna, okay, and they are providing some kind of, you know, this have some kind of optimized gain, okay. And also what it can be done, okay, that some kind of other antennas also, this was also done by another group that which worked with me, with some kind of, you know, some kind of periodic pattern, they had designed some antennas, okay, and come up with some kind of designs working in two different bands, okay, and they have also providing some kind of optimized or good gain, okay. And also you can make some kind of, you know, that the another antenna, it can, you can make it, okay, with a dual band antenna, you can make, okay, that is also providing some optimized gain, okay, with some you know, that with some good radiation patterns, okay. And also that we have worked with some kind of wearable antenna designs, okay, that in C band in 6 and 8 gigahertz. And what it has been done, that you can see that what is the main idea of this wearable antenna, that once you are having it, it should radiate in this direction, you should not have any kind of back radiation. So you can see that back radiation has been reduced considerably, and we are working further to make it a better way, okay. So we are trying to do this, okay. And also that one can make some kind of filters in the high frequencies, okay. These are some works which has been carried out, one of the band pass filter, you know, in the band pass filter what will happen, that sorry, this is a band stop filter rather. The band stop filter, what will happen over a particular band, your transmission will be reduced and your reflection will be high, okay. So that is the exactly the thing here, this is the transmission, this is the reflection, okay. And in the other case, you can have the transmission is enhanced and the reflection is reduced. So this is basically, you can consider this is nothing but the here you are having the band pass filter, okay. So why I am showing these works? These works have been carried out by some summer interns who had visited us, okay, in the past few years, okay. And and if you notice these works and which has been the references, so they have been published and accepted in some, you know, that some kind of frontline conferences in India, okay. And also it was published, in fact, the some of the polarization converters, okay, that which was worked, okay, that some people have worked. And what you can find out, the copolarized reflection is minimum and cross polarized reflection is maximum to get some kind of polarization conversions at some in the terahertz region. And here the angle difference between the co and cross is nearly 90 degrees. So that is the thing we have seen. And also make some kind of the this one also some kind of, you know, that another polarization conversion, okay, in the terahertz, in the, this was made in the gigahertz region, okay. And let me tell you that one of the BTech student who had graduated this year, okay, he had made some kind of, you know, some kind of innovative research with this kind of thing. So the other works, whatever I have shown you, that was made some kind of using some solvers. What this fellow had done, he had made, or he had developed an algorithm. And what you can do, one can see that, well, that if you are, that suppose you are needing that, that what, where you are having more than 90% transmission. So he had find out an algorithm, or he has developed an algorithm that, well, if I see, suppose these are the two ranges, two frequencies, F1 and F2, within this one you are having that more than 90% transmission. And then what he was doing, that he had made a binary search algorithm, and with the iteration itself, he has found out, well, at which particular value you should simulate to get an optimized result at a particular frequency, what will be a center frequency. So what has been done, that he has written over here, the whole search space is divided into two halves and the cutoff frequency has been determined accordingly. And based on the frequency determined, one of the two halves is discarded and the whole search space is divided into another half. And by this way, what is doing, that you are going with the truncation and further truncation, and he is coming with the result, okay. So this continues until both the left extreme and right extreme have their corresponding frequency difference less than the acceptable precision error. So already, well, suppose you want to make it at some few gigahertz or few terahertz, okay, you have to provide us a certain limit. So within that one, this has been designed and this has been developed, okay. And in fact, with this one, in fact, this is one of the very prestigious conference. It is going to have it in this August this year, okay. So there, this particular work has been accepted. Okay. And let me, before I end up, I want to show you the interns who had worked with me for the previous few years. In last year, unfortunately, due to the pandemic, we couldn't take any intern. This year also, I am afraid that we are having the same thing going to be repeated. Okay. And I want, before I end up, I want to acknowledge some few students. You can see my entire group over here, and I have kept that BTEC student photograph over here that who had developed this particular scope of this, that this binary search algorithm. Okay. And we also have certain collaboration, some students, some collaborative way also, they have worked with me. Okay. And still we are working together to get some kind of interesting results. And I also want to thank or acknowledge my collaborators that with whom I am working, and we are getting some very, very interesting results. Okay. And before I end up, again, I want to show you that our beautiful campus in IIT BHU. So here is my website. You can see, for any things you want to know about me, or for any update, you can just browse my website to get any kind of updates. And this is the temple which I have told about at the beginning of my talk, that within our temple, within our campus, we are having a beautiful temple. So this is the aerial view of the temple. You are most welcome to visit us. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Somak, sir. And it's always been very, what to say, I don't have word to speak all about you. It's always been like lovely to hear you, and whatever that you have presented to us, to our students, to our faculty members, it's unexplainable, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful talk. And now I'll request Srinivasu, sir, to please take over the session. Sir, please.
Yeah, sir. Gratitude is the attitude that sets the altitude for living.
Hello.
On the beautiful note.
Hello. Sir, before concluding, I want to tell something about sir. Sir.
Yeah, sir. Sure, sir.
Sir, very nice talk, sir. Really, I enjoyed your talk, sir. Today, completely 1 hour. This is Venkatesh Kumar, sir. So here, one small clarification is required, sir, from your side. Yeah. May I ask one?
Yes, sure.
I'm a very deep space lover, sir, actually. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, sir, give us a brief roadmap to how to get free telescopic data, and what parameters we can go for exploiting, sir.
Okay. From telescope, whenever you are designing a telescope, the very fundamental ones which you require is, first of all, that you have to, for example, if you consider the telescope, the very first thing you require, the gain of the amplifier, because a telescope, as I have told you, that it is nothing but a super heterodyne receiver. Okay, so whenever you are considering a super heterodyne receiver, okay, that what you are having, the very first stage you are having, you have to band limit the signal, okay, so that the noise should be low. The two things which are extremely important is the noise figure of the system, number one. Number two is the gain of the system. Okay, these two are the very fundamental things. And apart from that one, also that the other things will always come into the picture, like your frequency of operation and other ones, and what are the other parameters. And accordingly, based upon all these ones, you have to assemble, and you have to have a proper, you have to have a proper coupling between one element to another element, or one subsystem with another, to come out with the complete system.
Thank you very much, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much,
sir. Yes, sir. And one more thing, sir, you was talking about weapon detection and all, no? Mm-hmm. Is it that complete technology is established, or still we have any?
No. Complete technology in the terahertz region at all, it is not established. It is completely under experimental.
Okay.
And in fact, people are doing extensive research. And in fact, as I have told you, the most challenging one is that we don't have any kind of experimental facilities. Okay. So still it is in, or I should say the other way, it is in the simulating way.
Okay. Right, sir. I thank Ajay for introducing you, sir. We required maybe on behalf of EC department and Nagarjuna College, we extremely thank you, sir, for coming here and taking the session. It is a very grateful session for us, sir.
I'll be happy if I get any questions from the students. I'll be very happy to answer it.
Yeah. Yes, students, any questions from your end?
Yeah, students, any questions or any doubts you have, you can ask.
No, sir.
I think it is too much boring, right?
No, sir.
It's all very interesting, sir.
Yes, sir. They may reach you with your. You can also give your mail ID so that anything, they may at least like they can contact you in that way.
Okay, fine. I can write it in the chat box, I believe.
But I
will be very happy to answer any question. Means if someone is having anything, they have mind.
Sir, any help or any lab kind of help? So students, if they want, so they can approach your department.
Okay, fine. Yeah, I'll ask them to drop me an email with through proper channel.
Yes.
So that I can do that.
Yeah, even students are interested for internship or something. If any,
ask them to. In fact, one thing I'm telling you that yes, I used to consider after once they will complete the third year of BTech. Okay. And,
sure.
That is number one. And second thing is so they should approach with through the proper channel. Obviously, I will consider.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Ajay, you wanted to say anything?
Sir, as always, like Somak sir has presented the things in the best lucid way that we can all understand, and also the PPT comprises of different photographs of the latest technologies and the technologies that has been like used till date. And obviously, sir, I have been listening to you for like number of years. And that is why I wanted to call you here, and we all of us like need your help in the future as well. So yeah, thank you so much for the informative as always, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Can we conclude?
Srinivasu, sir. Yes, sir.
I would like to extend my deep sense of appreciation and sincere thank you to Dr. Somak, sir. We thank you, sir, for your immense and continuous knowledge sharing. Thank you very much, sir. We wholeheartedly thank management of Nagarjuna College of Engineering and Technology. On behalf of Department of Electronics and Communication and students, we also sincerely thank our principal, Dr. Jitendra Mungara, sir, for his continuous support and guidance. Also thank Dean and Quality Assurance, Dr. Mohan Kumar, sir. We also thank our head of the department, Professor Dr. Nagesh K.N. for his immense support and timely inputs. We would like to thank webinar conveyor Dr. Rohit Hess, sir, for his coordination. We also thank coordinators, Mr. Ajay Kumar Dwivedi, sir, and Srinivasa TV, sir, for their successful coordination to make this webinar happen. We thank all faculties of Department of ECE for their involvement in conducting this webinar. I also thank all the participants for their active participation. Thank you everyone. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. My special thanks to Ajay and Srinivas for taking keen interest in organizing and coordinating the things. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rohit.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Shall I end the session, sir?
Please.
Thanks.
Ajay, 1 minute. Let all participants can leave.
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Shall I stop recording, sir?
Please.